Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Check It Out, the library talk show that lets you know what's going on in and around the Bethel Park Library. We're your hosts, Elaine Volpe.
And Christine McIntosh.
And today's episode is of special interest. We are very excited to have Cheryl Capizzuti from Puppets for Pittsburgh on the show in just a little bit. Cheryl is a sculptor, painter, and Pittsburgh's premier puppet maker. So we're really happy she's going to be on, like I said, in just a little bit to talk us about the puppet making process and how she got started and all kinds of good stuff.
A real Renaissance woman.
Yes, for sure. But before we do that, let's find out what exciting things are happening in the different departments of the library. So what do you got for adults, Christine?
I have some adult stuff. On Monday, March 4th at 7 p.m., we are hosting a program on the Allegheny County Property Assessment Appeals process. We'll have attorneys from Barrand and Ernsberger here to help answer your questions on how to go about filing an appeal and what happens after the appeal process is started. A really great new program is 30 Apps in 30 Minutes. Kelly Beeson, our new instructional reference librarian, is starting a new program. 30 minutes, you get an app a minute. It's just kind of like a whirlwind. She's going to tell you about some fascinating and fun apps for your iPad, your iPhone. So that will be, actually we're doing that twice, Wednesday, March 13th at 7 p.m. and then again Thursday, March 21st at 10 a.m. So you have two choices. And Friday, March 15th at 11 a.m. is our annual Irish Tea Party. Michelle Loria and I put this tea party on, and it's a lot of fun. We have a group that comes. We do them usually quarterly, and we have a solid group that comes to those. We do ask for a $5 donation just to cover the cost of the food and the favors. We always have a favor. So if you are looking forward to something to do that's non-alcoholic before the St. Patrick's Day holiday, come join us for the Irish Tea Party. And another thing that we have going on is a creative writing seminar. This graduate student, and he's a published author. His name is Kenny Tomasitz. He created this program for the library. It's free of charge, and it's a creative writing seminar. It meets for 8 weeks on Saturday from 10 until noon, and he'll start off with a quick writing prompt and have you do some really quick speed writing, and then it's followed by a lecture on one facet of writing. And then there'll be a group discussion on various aspects of the craft of writing, such as plot, setting, characters. Regular attendance is not required. You don't have to come to all 8 sessions, but it is encouraged. You know, you learn more that way. This begins on Saturday, March 16th, and will run through May 4th, and registration is required so that we know how many to prepare for. And then a program that I have been trying desperately to make happen for a long time is Storytime for Adults. It's not a story appreciation hour. It is simply you come as an adult and I read a short story to you in its entirety during that session. I used to do it in the evenings. I had some people that actually come to our tea parties that said, oh, I would love to do that, but can you do it during the day? I don't really go out at night. So I'm trying it again. It will start Wednesday, March 20th. It will be at 11 a.m., Storytime for Adults, and I will be running that once a month. So I'll remind you whenever it's coming up. So that's what I have for adults. What's going on in youth services?
Well, we have a gaming club starting in March on Sundays at 1 o'clock. We're trying to grow this group. We have a couple people signed up. We would love to have some more. So it's going to be board games, trivia games, even video games. We're just going to try something different every Sunday in March. So call and register for our gaming club. And that's for anybody K through 5, really. We also have our Teen Would You Rather program coming up on March 15th, actually.
I love this program.
We talked about this on the last show, so I won't go into too much detail, but I will say that there's plenty of room still left to register, so call us today to get on the list for that one. And finally, we're starting a Pokemon Club Wednesdays in March at 6 o'clock. You can bring your cards if you have them, so you can maybe trade with some new friends. And if you know a lot about Pokemon, great, because you can share maybe with some members who are just kind of starting to get the interest and don't know a whole lot about it. Or you can share with the teacher, because we know nothing about it. I know that it's very, very popular, and we're happy to, you know, accommodate a group if they're interested, but I don't know a whole lot about Pokemon, so yeah, we will learn and explore together. But that's Wednesdays in March, and you do need to register for that. Of course, our full schedule of events is available online at bethelparklibrary.org. And you can also come and pick up this handy dandy condensed flyer that we just printed yesterday. This is all of what's left, programming March through May. And all age groups are represented on here. We have the family programs, birth through kindergarten, then your elementary age kids, and then the tweens and teens on the bottom. So everything is on here, or again, visit us online. And of course, you can call to find out more information too. Absolutely. About our programs and our services. Now, before we move on to the next segment of the show, I wanted to make a plea if I could.
Absolutely.
A plea of sorts. Christine, you mentioned our friends group on the last show, and I just want to remind viewers that they can join that group for, what is it?
It's $10 for an annual membership.
$10 for the year, so you can't beat it. But I have a specific project in mind for any adult who is willing to donate his or her time. As you know, and as many of the viewers know, for many, many years, we've been providing not only in-house programs, but a lot of outreach services. So we visit over 8 preschool and daycare centers on a monthly basis. Mm-hmm. And then we do extra programming. You know, we're on call for, and they can call and request a program anytime. So we also do that. So it's something that I feel very, very strongly about and that I will never willingly stop. But because of staff changes, budget cuts, and more sites requesting visits, we're finding it hard to maintain those monthly visits. It's just getting a little cumbersome. So we would love to train any volunteer. Maybe you're an older retired adult who has time during the day and who loves children. Really, the only two requirements are you have to like kids and you have to like books. And maybe you would like to go visit these centers and just do a 45-minute story time. Or maybe you're a stay-at-home mom who loves kids, but your kids are in school. And if you love books, then you can maybe visit these sites for us and just share 45 minutes to an hour of your time. So it's just something that's really important. I think reading is so obviously so beneficial, but it's very rewarding for both sides. The kids love it, but I think you'll feel great too. I love reading to kids. I don't think I'll ever get sick of that. So, like I said, it's a great service. We don't want to stop it, but we're making a plea for some help. So, of course, we would give you plenty of training before we sent you off on your own. You would have to have clearances, but the library would
pay for the clearances.
The cost of those. And so, yeah, just I encourage you to call me if you're interested. The number will show at the bottom of the screen there, and we'll give you more details and see if it's something that you might like to do. But I think it's a great opportunity,
I hope it is. It's a great thing, and like Elaine said, we like to stay out in the community. We're just having a difficult time having enough staff allocated to do that.
So. Right. So now our new segment of the show.
Yes.
We want to happily introduce our first 3 one-minute book reviews. Each month, we're going to aim to bring you 3 book recommendations, whether they be children's books, adult books, sometimes young adult books. But they'll all be available at our library or through the countywide request program. And our first reviewer is no stranger to the show. Barb Connell has graced us with her presence before. And so she is back again. She's an avid reader, and she always has plenty of recommendations. Following her review is Pat DeGregorios. Pat, too, is an avid reader, and I'm sure she'll be back for more reviews in the future. At least I hope they will.
They will.
And then, Christine, you're going to do one that you think our viewers might be interested in.
I am going to do one. I have done these in the past. Just, you know, it's kind of, we do this every day when people come in and they say,
exactly.
Oh, can you give me an idea of what I should read next? And so we kind of do these on the fly. We just say, okay, here's about this great book. This is what it's about, and this is why I think you should read it. So
yeah, so now we just want to give it out to more people, to all of you. So we thank all of our contributors, and we hope that you will take their recommendations and try one of their books sometime soon. So without any further ado, here's what they've read and enjoyed lately.
Ray Bradbury died this past year. His famous science fiction is read by high school students everywhere. In fact, Fahrenheit 451 is required reading. Since I don't care much for science fiction, I didn't think I would really like Ray Bradbury until our book club here at the library chose one of his books, Dandelion Wine. I was very happy to find out that it wasn't science fiction at all, more autobiographical. The summer of 1928 was a vintage year for a small-town boy growing up in Illinois. There was lots of green apple trees, new sneakers, and helping Grandpap pick dandelions for his wine. Ray Bradbury is a masterful storyteller. With his vivid metaphors, He captures this magical summer in the life of 12-year-old Douglas Spaulding. You'll be right there with Douglas, walking along those scary, dark ravines in the woods and going through the spring ritual, helping Grandpap hang up the porch swing. I wrote Ray Bradbury a letter and told him how much our book club enjoyed his books and how he helped us recapture our childhood. We were thrilled when he took the time to answer our letter. I especially liked the things that he had to say about libraries and what an important part they played in his life. After thanking us for our letter, he said, "You'll be happy to know that I have lectured in at least 60 libraries in the past few years. I am, after all, a library-educated chap. I wasn't able to attend college, but went instead to hide out in the library stacks and came out in the light at age 28 with a complete education." He even sent us a wine label promoting Dandelion Wine. Love to my Thursday morning book club members, Ray Bradbury. I hope you read Dandelion Wine. It'll help you remember what it was like being a kid, and you'll find out why he's such a respected writer. Thank you.
I'm Barb, and the book that I have chosen to recommend is called The Midwife, also previously published as The Midwife. It's by Jennifer Wirth, and it's a memoir of her time during the 1950s as a midwife in the East End slums of London. I was inspired to read this book in a roundabout way. Mary Mullen, during her last show on Check It Out, had recommended the show called The Midwife, which is a BBC show that aired on PBS in the fall. And the libraries got the DVD, and I checked out the DVD, and I thought it was a really, really excellent and wonderful series. So I thought, I think I'll try the book. And it is also an excellent book. And I really felt as though this is a case of a book that a series was made from, and I really like them both equally. And typically, I usually like the book better. But in this case, I thought they were both wonderful. Jennifer is like approximately 22 years old. She leaves a very comfortable life and goes to live with nuns and other ladies who are midwives in a convent. And it just goes into so many wonderful stories, a lot of which are pretty graphic in their description of what times were like in that time. And I'm really glad that now that I have a daughter who's having a baby, that she will not be having her baby under these circumstances. So if you are, if you're interested in reading this, you might also be interested in watching the TV series. It's truly, truly wonderful. Thank you.
Hi, it's Christine with a 1 minute book review on The Cellist of Sarajevo by Stephen Galloway. This book is set in Sarajevo during the siege in the early 1990s. It's about a musician who decides to play his cello at the site of a mortar attack for 22 days in honor of the 22 people that died while waiting in a bread line. And drawn into his orbit are three strangers, a bakery worker, a young father, and a female who happens to also be a sniper. The book follows the daily lives of these four strangers and explores how war can change your definition of humanity and how just the rituals of daily life can be a form of resistance, and just also illustrates how futile and random war can be. What I liked about this book is that it's not a political statement. A lot of books that I've read about the war in the former Yugoslavia are either very anti-Serbian or anti-Muslim. This does not have that overt. There's some clues in there, and if you're familiar with the region, you might be able to pick up on them. I had to call a friend of mine and ask about some of the things I didn't understand. But it is a book on humanity, not a book about war. It is uplifting, even at times through the horrific conditions that these people had to live under. But it's about choosing to do what is right in the worst of situations. It's a very moving experience. And if you liked The Kite Runner or A Thousand Splendid Suns, this is a book that's in the same vein. So hope you like it. ¶¶
Welcome back, everyone. And we are joined by our very special guest. This is Cheryl Capizzuti. Not only Cheryl, but all of her friends as well. And we are ecstatic to be showcasing these friends for the next couple of months, showcasing them, but also performing with them this summer. So we're very excited about that. We thought it'd be great to have Cheryl on this show so she can talk more about the process and how she goes about making these puppets and how she came to start lending them really to the libraries for our use. So why don't we start with your background, Cheryl?
Sure.
Start from the very beginning.
The very beginning. Well, I'm a puppet maker, and I've been making giant puppets in the city of Pittsburgh for almost 20 years now. And I've been loaning them out to libraries for about seven, or not to libraries, to anyone in the community. Lots of people ask me, like, how did you get started doing this kind of work? And, you know, my story is like that of a lot of artists. I got out of college with a degree in integrative arts, which is kind of like a degree in nothing practical. And I got lucky to work at a small art center on the campus of Penn State. And we would have different artists that came through that center. And one was Sarah Peaty, who was a puppet maker who traveled around the country sharing her work with communities and encouraging people to sort of build their own puppet communities. And because I worked there, I was her assistant for a week. And then the community where I was living asked me to make some puppets. And then they asked me to make a couple more. And over a couple years, I made a dozen or more puppets. And when I moved back to Pittsburgh, which is where I'm from, I had a little portfolio with all these pictures of puppets, and I showed them to people, and I said, I'm a puppet maker, and they believed me.
That's a great story. That's such a great story, and it's great that you've been able to make a career out of it for 20-plus years. I mean, that's awesome, and what fun.
Yeah.
We got to actually go on location, I guess, last month when we were picking out our puppets, and it was so funny just for you just to lift up the garage door, and there were literally, 200 puppets just stacked one upon the other, and I was just, like, in awe.
Right.
It was really hard to choose 15. But, so just talk about the actual process. You work out of your home.
Right. I do. So I start most of a big chunk of the work I do is for First Night Pittsburgh, and I started out producing their parade on and off different years since about 1998. I've been doing that, and every year we make puppets. And because I know I'm going to want to use them again next year, I keep adding to the collection and making new ones. And, you know, at some point, you know, like when you have 10 or 15 or 40 puppets, you think like, oh, I've got all these nice puppets. Right. And then when you hit like 150, 160, 200 puppets, you think, oh my goodness.
What am I going to do? I'm going to take my home.
So, my process is very community spirited. I don't make things alone. Almost everything I make is made in workshops with collaborators, with people from all over the place. It's kind of like pick up basketball for creative people. And so I don't think of the puppets necessarily as belonging to me. I think of them as belonging to the community. So for a number of years, I've had funding from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts to loan my puppets out like a library, just out of my garage. So any nonprofit could call me up and say, hey, we want a puppet for our little parade.
Right, whoever it may be, right?
Right.
Church organization.
Anybody.
Or...
And it got to the, and so I started doing that very casually. It became happening more and more. And it hit a point where it would be like, okay, your puppet penguins are on the front porch on the left. Don't take the giraffes. They're going somewhere else, but I can't be home. So when you return them, bring them here. And it became a really elaborate and crazy system getting puppets out to the world. So I started talking to friends about formalizing my connection with libraries and working not just to loan them or let libraries use them, but actually cataloging the collection and loaning them out through the library system to anyone with a library card. We're not quite there yet.
Which is quite a process.
Right.
But just so you know, I mean, that process has already been started. It's underway. And so eventually what Cheryl is saying is you will be able to check some of these puppets out, some of the smaller ones that you see up front, as well as some of the body puppets. We call these backpack puppets.
I call them backpack puppets, yeah.
And so that's a really exciting thing. And we hope to have that done within the next couple months, hopefully by the summer, I think, if we're on track.
The timeline for those kinds of things, they just take a little longer. There's a lot of moving parts right now.
Right.
But I'm excited about it. And what's cool about partnering with the Bethel Park Library with you is that we're getting a chance to see how a community will use them when they have them over time at a library, and to start to build excitement for the process and to really just share them with the world. My goal is to, you know, to share this work with you, the viewer, and anyone else in the region that would like to use giant puppets for anything. I mean, when you have 200 giant puppets, you might as well use them for something.
Now, do you have a favorite? Out of all the ones that you've created over the years, do you have a favorite puppet?
You know, like, for me, the favorites are the ones that are often most recently completed that embrace new challenges. Like, for example, I have some new pieces that I finished for First Night this year that use electroluminescent wire incorporated into the puppet, so the puppets light up. And for I love those pieces because they sort of mark like a challenge to myself as an artist. And I learned a lot by working with a lighting designer, Andy Ostrowski, is really cool. And so for me, the challenge as an artist and a puppet maker is always to be doing something new. And when you do something new, it's exciting.
Yes.
You know? So I always love the new ones best. Sure. But there's some old favorites as well.
Yes, I'm sure. Well, this is probably a good time then to talk about what Bethel Park plans on doing with the puppets. We are actually starting a puppet troupe. I think I mentioned it to you.
Yeah, right. That's exciting.
For tweens and teens. So anyone fifth grade and up who might be interested in working with these puppets from the very beginning, as far as writing the script, getting to know the puppets, incorporating them into a show, and then hopefully performing at the puppet party in May, and then again all summer long. We would love to have this together so that you guys could perform at our kickoff carnival for summer reading, and then also take it on the road, so to speak, to different daycare centers and nursing homes and whatnot.
What
so
fun.
We are really trying to develop this puppet troupe. We already have 6 interested members, but I think with as many puppets as we have, there's plenty of parts for everyone, right, for more.
And if you had run out of puppets, you could come get more.
I can always say that. It's a fun field trip to take, trust me, a very fun field trip. But I also want to, so they will kind of, like I said, we're working on how we're going to showcase them up in the library. So you'll be seeing them in the library when you visit, hopefully within the next couple weeks. But they're going to make their debut, so to speak, at our first puppet repair party. Can you tell viewers a little bit about what a puppet repair party entails?
Part of my process, you know, when you loan puppets out to the world, they don't last. They get broken fingernails and nicks and dents and things like that.
Our lion's missing eyelashes upstairs.
Right, exactly. A lion's missing eyelashes. And I never get upset about that. But part of the process of maintaining the library is teaching people how to take care of the puppets. And by teaching them by taking care of them. So at our puppet repair party, what will happen is people will come, will look at all the puppets that belong to this library right now, and we'll assess any issues that we need to solve. And I'll teach people my process while we fix their hands and give them new eyelashes and that kind of thing. At that workshop, I'll also bring a project where we start from scratch, cool, where many hands can work together on creating a new parade mask or something new for your library collection as well.
Awesome. So we're very excited about that. And that's something that all ages can be a part of, right?
Right, absolutely.
From the little ones all the way up to the grown-ups, the adults. We want it to be a family process, yep, actually. So that is scheduled, I believe, for Saturday, May 18th is what we decided
on. That sounds right, yeah.
And it will actually be held at the community center so we can accommodate more people. And we'll be providing more information to you about that shortly, but yeah, mark your calendars for Saturday, May 18th.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun, and it's a nice way to get to know the puppets inside and out, to understand how they're made, and to feel like you are part of the process too, because you are.
Yes, absolutely. Are there any other exciting projects that you want to tell viewers about? Past projects?
Sure. I work as an artist, so I don't just make puppets. I do all kinds of other work, and I do have a rather quirky project coming up. It's an art installation in a laundromat, and the art is made completely out of dryer lint.
So, it's crazy. It's fascinating.
So people actually from all over the city have been giving me their dryer lint, and I'm in the production process right now of making a flock of flying creatures that will be installed on the ceiling of the laundromat.
And some of those I saw on your website. We right. will have the website running at the bottom of the screen, so I right. encourage you to check out Cheryl's website. Yeah, I saw some of the flying right. creatures, yeah, and it's just so cool. People literally from all over the U.S. have been sending her laundry lint.
Yeah, and they're, you know, it's hard to imagine what they would be unless you actually see them, and yeah. they're really yeah. pretty, like it sounds crazy and nutty, and it is crazy and nutty.
But that's what makes it so awesome, right? though.
So I encourage you, that show is opening Saturday, March 23rd from 5 to 7 at a laundromat in my neighborhood called Trey's Laundromat in Brighton Heights in Pittsburgh. So
awesome.
A little drive from Bethel Park, but not too
that's
far.
That's okay. Well worth the drive, definitely.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. Well, we want to thank you very much for being here, Cheryl, for sharing these awesome works of creation. The puppets are just, like I said, if you could see her garage, it was just fascinating. It was so hard for me to choose. You will be seeing more of these puppets very soon. And we just thank you for all that you've done. And we look very forward to working with you in the future.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me today.
Sure
thing. This was really fun.
Okay, and we're going to end this evening's show with a program highlight. The following clip is from our Teen Pizza Taste Off, where 12 teens came out and sampled pizza from 5 different local shops. And the winner was Pizzarella Pizza for the 3rd year in a row. They are the reigning champs. But a great time was had by all, and this is most likely a program that we will offer again in the near future. So enjoy the clip, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Bethel Park Library Tween and Teen Pizza Taste Off. Our friends here tonight are going to be sampling pizza from 5 different local shops, and we will announce the winner at the end. So I'm going to assume that you guys are pizza lovers.
Pizza love.
What did you think of pizza number one?
I think it was pretty good, except for the crust, probably not the best.
Okay, so the crust wasn't the best, but Jesse, you gave it a 5 in overall, so not bad. Nasiah, what did you think of pizza number one?
It wasn't that bad, but the crust was horrible.
So there's some agreement about the crust here. So the crust can definitely be improved. All right, well, shortly you'll be testing or sampling pizza number two. You may. Sure, Kyle, what do you want to say?
Hi, Mom.
Can you guys introduce yourselves and tell everybody at home who you are? Just your first name is fine.
I'm Samantha.
I'm Blake.
Anna.
Anna, all right. And so earlier before we started rolling the tape, you guys said that you considered yourself pizza connoisseurs, right? So you eat a lot of pizza. And even though you don't know which 5 you're sampling tonight, do you have any guesses as to what Bethel Park shop might win? Or what's your favorite?
I'm going to say Little Caesars.
Okay, Little Caesars.
I like Luciana's.
Luciana's?
I think Danny's might win. I don't
Danny's. Okay. All good guesses. Well, I guess we will see at the end of the show. Well, thank you girls for being here, and go enjoy your pizza. Ladies and gentlemen, and to all our viewers at home, the results are in. I'd like to first announce the 5 participating pizza shops, though. Domino's participated, and we thank them. We thank each and every one of them. Pizzarella, Bocelli, Italian Village, and Mm-mm Pizza. And again, to each of you, thank you so much for your participation. Okay, thank you very, very much. And here are the results. Drum roll, please. Okay. Ready? Best crust. We actually had a tie. Tying for best crust was Domino's and Pizzarella. The best cheese, Pizzarella. Best sauce, Pizzarella. And as you might have guessed, best overall taste, Pizzarella.
And remember, as always, if you want more information about our programs or services, you can always click on our website, give us a call, or better yet, stop by and see us in person. See you next month.